Well, it's good to be with you again. For those of you who walked in a little late, there's an old Jacob's Porch board member. Good to see you, Eric. I'm the pastor at Your Campus Ministry located at The Ohio State University, known as Jacob's Porch, and it's my delight to be with you again. I was here in November, and it was really great. I announced that, like, hey, if anybody wants to give some money to help with some electric bills or heating bills, and some of you did. You actually did, and I appreciate that. You know, there's lots of ways to connect to Jacob's Porch. If you have any students or anybody you know, please contact me. I'd love to reach out to them. Also, if you'd like to connect to our newsletter or give a gift online, please do that. Also, this summer, we'll be sending out notice. It'll probably come through your bulletins here. You can ask the pastors about it, of ways that if your family wanted to come at the beginning of the fall semester, maybe a group of families, and prepare meals for hundreds of students. We do meals almost every day for a month because I have to get to know the neighborhood, the entire neighborhood, every year, right? Because everybody moves out and moves in. And so we do like a month straight of meals outside. And it's usually a ton of fun. My family comes, other families are there, churches are there. So if anybody would get excited about being on the Ohio State campus right at the beginning of the fall semester, it's always a lot of energy and fun, please look for that. So today, I thought I'd dwell for a moment on these words from Paul. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. We proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews, and foolishness to Gentiles. Why would Christ being crucified be foolishness to Gentiles? That's what we're going to get into today. You know, 11 years ago, I've been at Jacob's Porch now 11 years, the ministry looked different than it does today, and that's because students were different 11 years ago than today. When I think back to my first few years there, a lot of what we did was we were having conversations with atheists. There were some debating, like Christian fundamentalists that would come. We'd have gatherings and conversations, or people would show up and want to debate me. It was kind of that kind of intensity, and it was fun. I loved all of it. But you kind of had the atheist crowd, those who were, a lot of them were burned out from Christianity. They knew about Christianity, they experienced one form of Christianity, and now they were atheists because they didn't like it. Or, so we either kind of faced that kind of group, or the other kind of group was those that were burned out from a fundamentalist kind of Christianity. And that was a lot of what we did. And these people, either atheist or burned out Christian, they actually knew what Christianity was. They knew some of the stories. And we were, you know, the conversations were mostly around with the atheists of just, you know, can you believe in an enchanted world? Can you even believe in a God? You know, making arguments that were philosophically coherent, that kind of thing. Or making apologies for the kind of Christianity that they had experienced. And while that was, I enjoyed part of that, I got a little tired of that, you know, making philosophically coherent ideas. Or saying these Christians are wrong, you know, I mean, they're still brothers and sisters in Christ, you know, it just kind of got a little tiresome, I think. But now, these last 4 years, it's a totally different kind of student who's coming in. At least that we're seeing, right? And these students have no idea of the Christian faith. Very, very little. Something they picked up stuff on the internet, but they haven't experienced it. They don't know the stories. In fact, the beginning of over the summer, we did our planning. One thing I asked the students was, what do you want to talk about this year? And they said, can you just teach us the basic Bible stories? Because we're in these English lit classes, and we're finding a lot of references to the Bible in there, and none of us, and really it doesn't seem like our professor knows what these stories are. Can you help us learn these? I'm like, teach you more about the Bible? Yes, we can do that. That's our specialty. And then something else has happened. So, like, at the end of the millennials, you know, the last generation, that was at the beginning of my time, there wasn't so much of this thing called spiritual but not religious going on. now like 50% of Gen Z is spiritual but not religious. Okay, what does that mean? It means a lot of things. One, they don't know much about Christianity. They haven't experienced it. Two, I call it like the TikTokification of religion. So they have lots of different spiritual practices of all kinds. They're not really well thought through, and they aren't part of like a Wiccan group specifically that's digging deep into the religion or, you know, all these different things. They've kind of learned a few things on YouTube or TikTok, and they're entering in, and they have like constructed a religion, kind of, some spiritual practices, kind of, that scratch that itch of spirituality for them. And I love this. I love this. Because for me, this is natively where Christianity has existed. It's only recently when most people didn't, or a big chunk of people didn't believe there were, you know, any gods of any kind, right? That's kind of a recent thing. And I think that the New Testament sings more beautifully when we're kind of on campus surrounded by pagans, you know, said in the most generous of terms. People that don't know about Christianity and for whom they've learned all these kind of religions, surface level, many of them, that tie some of them back to the Romans. It's like these kind of odd manifestations of religion that have cycled through, gone through TikTok, and now a student is like, I'm going to believe this thing because, look, this person has 500,000 influencers. This religion must be right. I mean, this is my life. This is what happens. I'm not kidding. This is what happens every week at Jacob's Porch. And maybe you know some young people like this. Maybe you are one of those folks too. And if so, we love you. And I think the message of the gospel can just sing more clearly into that group. And I'm enjoying it more than just atheist debates or, you know, kind of bashing on fundamentalists. So when we read about Paul and this foolishness to Gentiles, we have to kind of go back and ask the question, what was the wisdom, what was the religion of these Roman Gentiles like in the first place? Why is this foolishness? Why is Christ crucified discussed in the midst of this? What are some markers of the religious landscape that Paul was in and out of which the New Testament was written? Because it really brings things into, a stark relief. So first of all, we've got to realize that everybody was religious in the first century. There was this thing called the Pax Deorum, the peace, to have peace with the gods, or the peace of the gods. And this was a state religion, this was family religion, this was individual piety, all working together for two purposes. To consolidate the state identity of the Roman Empire, and to make sure that the gods weren't going to do anything bad to us, because they often would do that, because they weren't very trustworthy or good people, and that they might give us just a little something. Just a little something to help us get ahead in this world. When you woke up in the morning, religion. When you walk out in the streets, religion. You could probably smell the sacrifices and the smoke in the air. When you went to any kind of meeting or guild or whatever, religion was everywhere. Common conversation was, what'd you think of Zeus? What do you think of Artemis? This was just everywhere. And I think that's hard for us to understand, that most of your life was driven towards having peace with the gods, and there were certain protocols and state requirements for you to have peace with the gods. Because if the gods had peace with Rome as a whole, then Rome could conquer their enemies and so on and so forth and prosper. So the first image that they would have had, whether they stated it out loud or not, would have been a strong pyramid of power. Okay, that was mirrored on heaven and on earth. So the overwhelming vast majority of people would have been poor. Then you had, once you, you kind of go up the pyramid, the people at the very top, very small percentage, would have owned everything. And these people at the top were also the ones that were appointed by the state to be priests and to do sacrifices to the gods for the Romans. And this was mirrored in heaven, so to speak, the celestial realm, where you had the lower gods that weren't quite as cool or powerful, like Pan, you know, the goat man, you know, and then you'd have all the way up to Jupiter or Zeus at the top. And, you know, my boys and I, we watch Marvel movies and Star Wars, and most of our conversation in the week is, so, Dad, who's more powerful? Is it Thanos or Scarlet Witch? Who's the better Jedi, Dad? Do you think it's Anakin or Luke? You know, those are the, and that's the kind of conversations that would have been going on every day with the Romans. And if you were at the bottom, like the masses at the bottom, you were just hoping and working for generations to get just one notch above. And it was largely a caste system. So for somebody to rise above, somebody else would probably have to go down. Because the higher up you were, the more access you had to the better gods, and therefore you could get more things. This is just kind of like basic Roman religion, how it worked. And then sometimes the people at the very top, like the Roman Caesar, they could then cross over and go into the celestial realm. They could become a hero and move on up. The Pontifex Maximus, the highest priest, was also, you know, that person at the top. Or the senators, many of whom were the priests. They were of such an order and so high in society, they could just kind of tip into the divine realm. And everybody wanted to do that. A big competition to get to the top. And it really is even kind of worse and more shocking than that. They practice something called physiognomy. Okay, what does that mean? You know, we've heard it said, it's not on the outside, but what's on the inside that counts, or whatever. We say that because it was the opposite. If you were attractive, if you were better looking, taller, if you didn't have any physical disfigurements or birthmark on your face, this helped you get higher. So if you were born and you had some kind of physical disfigurement, you weren't particularly attractive based on the societal standards, this would move you down. You're going to perpetually kind of be at the bottom of the rung if you were born with a birthmark on your face. And all anybody wanted to do was get close, higher up the power ladder, so you could have a little bit of access to God. This is why they would go to festivals, because now you've got all the rich people, they're making big sacrifices, and maybe if we're just close by putting our prayers in, accidentally, one of the good gods will hear us and will bless us in some way. But there was just really no hope, because everything was so stratified, and there was very little way for anybody to move up. Now, every once in a while, the gods would come down. Just hang with me. There will be a point to all this. I won't just keep doing history for 40 minutes, so that would be fun. The gods would come down, usually for immoral bad reasons, and they would take on the persona of a human and do something. And then they would quickly want to get out of that mortal form because it was bad and gross. You were vulnerable, and it just wasn't good for your divineness. So you'd come down a little bit, and then you'd go up to where you were in the pyramid and escape back. That was the wisdom of the Gentiles. And now you have a God come in, born humbly to a woman, and as this man grows up, others call him God, he calls himself God. And what happens? He's crucified in flesh and dies. So this is some coming from the highest realm. This God comes all the way down, and not just to the bottom of the poorest of the poor, but below that as one who was crucified, treasonous, imprisoned. And all of a sudden, for everybody else, for all those who were poor and could never get ahead, those that were ugly and could never get ahead, all of a sudden they had a champion. And guess what? This champion named Jesus Christ, he didn't just flee out of his mortal form. No, he becomes glorified. But what do Christians believe? He's always both divine and human. Even after his resurrection and ascension, he's still in human form, whatever glorified human form is. But the people saw this and they said, look, there's one of our own who has ascended all the way to the top, cut through all those layers. We have one of our own up there, everybody. And guess what? We are in him. He has taken us up to the highest celestial court. Can you believe it? Even the poor, the slaves, the disfigured, the lowly. This religion turned everything upside down. For now we have access to God Most High, because this one is one of us. Not the senator, not the Caesar, but one of us. The pyramid. Upturning it. Foolishness to the Gentiles. Another thing to understand is that people had very limited access to the gods, to the divine. There were certain hot spots around, right? There were certain hot spots. Oh, before I get to that, I want to tell a quick story that illustrates this with one of my students. One of my students who's not Christian, doesn't know much about Christianity. They've learned more about Christianity over the last year. But when they came in, I was getting to know them. They were telling me, you know, they practiced certain ritual spiritual practices. They didn't say they found it on TikTok, but I suspect so. And what they were doing, as I was asking lots of questions, was when they were at home, they thought they found a spell online where they could do a certain ritual acts, put something valuable to them and cut it or burn it and say some words and whatnot. There's no real specific deity invoked, kind of just the universe. But they were saying that they and their partner were doing this often. I said, well, why are you doing this? And they said, well, if the spell works, you know, I want this person who's ahead of me to stumble so I can get ahead, was basically the story. Now, this is a really nice person, and I was the one who said, kind of put it in those terms to them. You're praying, you're doing all these rituals so that somebody stumbles and falls, and so you can get ahead. I said, why would you do that? That's so manipulative and coercive. And they said, well, now that you put it like that, I guess, but it makes me feel close to God if something like that would happen and that I get ahead. And what was my first thought? Roman religion. I said, what if you believed in one that you didn't have to coerce or manipulate for love or access? That you don't have to, others don't have to go down so you can go up to be close to God and to be heard by God. That student hasn't converted yet, but they come every week and they're learning more about Christianity, because to them, Christianity seems foreign. And that ties into the hot spots, where you had to go to a particular temple, particular place, to have more access for divine favors. Religions, you know, you have temples, priests, all those kind of things, maybe some sacred areas. And some of these festivals, the poor didn't even have enough money to attend. Sometimes the temple taxes were so high you couldn't get in to make an offering. At a large festival, maybe you'd show up on the outskirts, again, just hoping that, you know, by a whim, your little prayer could be heard over everything else. But there wasn't much hope that you had access. I mean, this is just how it worked. And these big festivals would have meals, and you'd have the richest and the most prestigious at the heads of the tables, and the poor largely couldn't even attend these, right? The Christians come along, and they have a table, and Paul criticizes the Corinthians because they still have the Roman mindset of the wealthy get to eat first and sit at the head of the table. And he criticizes them and says, no, 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 the poor and the slaves can come up. Let them come up first for a change. And we're not sacrificing in blood all this stuff to appease a god. We'll talk about appeasement in a moment. But it's a table and a meal, a self-offering of God in a meal to us of God's presence. But the Christians would also say, yes, we worship collectively in a space, maybe a household or a workshop at that time, but we have access to God anywhere. What does the book of Hebrews said? That Christ has ascended into the heavens and is mediating on our behalf to the Father. And so Christians had this revolutionary idea at the time that no matter where you were, you had access to God. It wasn't limited to certain hotspots or to certain people. And it reminded me of another story of a student. I had TikTok religion on my brain as I was putting this sermon together. You'll see why. I was talking to a student. This was during the pandemic. and they weren't a Christian. And they were saying they were like going out. They were kind of a part of our community, kind of checking it out. But we were mostly online at that point. But they were going out into the woods, and they said they found a sacred tree. And I was like, what religion is that? Well, it's this thing with this. I didn't never heard of whatever it was. But in their mind, they had to go 25 minutes away to the sacred tree that they found on a walk, and that was the place they could pray. And I said, is that the only place you feel like you can pray, and why do you do that? And they said, in this place, I don't feel so lonely. In this place, I have a spiritual feeling, and I feel like God is this tree and is listening to me, and I feel better about myself. Now, did I like condemn going out into the woods and being by a tree? No, that can be great. There's special places for me out in nature. But for them, I could tell through further conversation that it was this limited access idea. This is the one place where I can feel close to God. This is the one place where I feel better about myself. And they didn't have a car. They either had to borrow a car or find a way to get there. And so they were completely limited on how often they could do this. And what was and then as we began to talk, I said, well, that's, you know, the religion you're following. Another one, the one that we practice here at Jacob's Porch that you've been coming to, is we have access to God at all times, and it's pretty miraculous. I can pray to God. Just wherever I'm standing is holy ground. I can pray to God. Yes, we come to worship for a special time, but we do that because we're not just individuals, we're part of the body of Christ. But you can come into anywhere you're at. God is near you and will hear you. And wherever you're at, God will love you. And you're not alone. And the funny thing was, over time, if you come to Jacob's Porch now, there's plants everywhere. You know, there's several reasons for that. One reason was this student, who I didn't ask them to give up the tree. I think they still probably do that. But they ended up bringing little plants. There's a couple little plants there that they would set, you know, in our area. And that just helped them, you know, to be near that plant. But also that plant was mobile. And they really connected to some of these plants. I'm not making fun of it. A lot of us connect. I kill plants, so I don't connect to them. But some of you might, you know. But that was Roman religion They had to be at a certain space, certain time, and it was limited to a few. And the last thing I'll say is one of the big things in Roman religion too, this wisdom of the Gentiles, was that we had to appease the gods. Because if you've read any Roman history and you've seen what those gods do, like they're pretty much awful most of the time. Really, really awful. And so the appeasement idea was that if you just got enough blood and smoke, slaughtered enough animals, it would be like putting the quarter in the payphone. You know, that now God would take notice. Or probably half of you don't know what a payphone, you know, hasn't put a quarter in a payphone before. If you're on Instagram and you put a heart button, you know, you might get that person's attention. But that was it. Appeasement. If we do all these things, we sacrifice all these things, maybe, just maybe, the gods will take notice of us. No promises. And it was very costly. And just the thought that you had to appease a God that was going to get you. Now, I heard a lot of this also from the fundamentalists way back when of, you know, kind of the sinners in the hands of an angry God. That was Roman religion too. Now, we do offer sacrifices as Christians. Lutherans, we actually don't call this a sacrifice, the communion. That's not a sacrifice. This is a promise of God of forgiveness, love, and presence with us. And we're not sacrificing anything, even though there's wine and blood involved. They changed that idea from the Romans to this. But more importantly, we still do make sacrifices. What are they? Our time, our bodies. What does Paul say? Offer your bodies as living sacrifices. In Matthew, says God says, I don't tithe me your mint, dill, and cumin. I don't care about that. I care about the weightier matters, like love, justice, and mercy. Offer your body as living sacrifices. We don't have to pay God back to get something. God's already done it in Jesus Christ. We don't have to do anything to get God's favor. It's already been given. But we are asked to still do a sacrifice, which is what? Serving and loving our neighbors. We're not like throwing blood and smoke back up to God to make God happy. It's that oxymoron of a living sacrifice, which makes no sense. Foolishness. But that's what we are. One of our students came to worship service, and sometimes after worship, we will take food out onto the streets and pray with people. Usually homeless, but not always. And oftentimes what we'll sing right before that is the worship song, Madly, maybe you've sung that here before, of that what we do in here, fill the streets out there, is the chorus. And we'd sing that at the end of worship, and then I would give like a, you know, the final blessing, but also say, but now your worship continues in the sacrifice of your body. As a living sacrifice. And we would go out and pray with folks. And a student asked, how is that worship? That doesn't look like worship. I thought worship is what only happened here. And I said, well, for Christians, it's just different than for Romans. What God desires, if we are to make sacrifice, is our time, our treasure, our just going out and serving. And that student was shocked, and they ended up taking, this is before the pandemic, we did this more regularly, and they started a whole student group called Crosswalk that did this all the time. And lastly, I'll just finish with this. As I've read a lot of history and gone into Roman religion, a lot more in the last 3 or 4 years that I've needed to keep up with where my students are at, I found it interesting that a lot of the early Romans, not Christians, they didn't really call Christians Christians. They didn't really know what Christ was, because that was kind of more of a Jewish concept. So what they heard was Crestus. If you've ever read Josephus or Celsus, they call Christians followers of Crestus, or Christ the Crestus. But Crestus, yes, it sounds like Christ, even in Greek, but it actually has a meaning, that word. What the word Christus meant, what all the pagans were calling the Christians, the word meant essentially a tool. Why are you all such tools, they would say. Why are you out helping all these people? You're such tools. You're Christus. You're such tools. And the Christians, over like about a century and a half, people kept saying this, and they started to wear it as a badge of honor. We are Christusians. They knew it was all messed up, but they wore it as a badge of honor, because the other meaning of Christus, slightly changed, is the word for kind. And so these Christians at those early centuries, they were saying, yeah, you want to call us kind tools as an insult? That's exactly what we are, because we offer our bodies as living sacrifices. You know, you and I might find it hard to believe that at any point in time, there would be this such a pyramid of power that you wouldn't be able to connect to a God. We might find it odd that some people, a lot of people used to think you can't have access to God. We might think it odd that somebody would think a sacrifice is serving somebody else. But every time we come in worship, the stories we read, the liturgy itself points us to these values that are foolish to the wisdom of the Gentiles. And in this new age, as it seems like the old gods are coming back through TikTok in some way, I find it exciting because the Christian message is so different than that. And students are more able to see who Jesus is, what it means that he is the crucified one given to glory, and that he is worthy of our worship and praise. Amen.